Hopefully we're on track for the plan.
Everything's on pace.
Couple months away.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really soon.
Right, halfway, spring break?
March, forget it's March.
Could probably do some quick intros.
Sure, yeah. You wanna go through the slides and we'll just start our bios and everything?
Yeah, well, I was thinking them too.
Alright.
So, you guys wanna go around real quick, just tell us your name and maybe where you're from originally?
I'm a person on it.
Sure.
So I'm Nick Lyons, I'm from Biddeford, Maine, I'm a business management major. And I'm actually in Taylor's class for an internship. What's the class name again?
Success in internships.
Success in internship, yeah.
Nice, awesome, good deal.
Yeah.
Excellent, welcome.
My name's Josh McCourt, also a sophomore. I'm a marketing and management major and I work with Taylor too in the business office right over there.
Great major.
Sorry?
That was my major.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, where are you originally from?
Marble, Massachusetts.
Okay, cool.
My name's Owen, I'm a marketing and management major as well. I'm from Newburyport, Massachusetts, and I'm a junior.
Great.
Awesome, love Newburyport.
Oh, just when you're taking a drink of the Coke.
Hi, how's it going? My name's Marshall Feeney and I'm from Marshfield, Massachusetts. I'm a marketing and management major and I'm a senior, so.
Excellent.
Welcome.
Nice to meet you guys.
I just met a kid yesterday from Marshfield, Massachusetts, that's a UMaine guy. What was his name? Remember?
Matt Flurry.
Yeah, Matt.
Matt Flurry, yeah. You know Matt?
What was his name?
Matt Flurry.
Flurry.
Flurry. Flurry.
Yeah, I know.
Marshfield.
Sounds familiar.
From your town. Alright. Anyway, fun fact.
I probably would know him if I was someone.
Okay.
My name's Sean, I'm from Little Maine and I'm a marketing major with a concentration in information systems.
Okay.
Alright.
My name is Paige McKelly, I'm originally from Fairfield, Connecticut, and I'm a management major. I'm a senior as well, graduating.
In-laws are in Fairfield, they go to Fairfield every year.
It's very nice.
Yeah, well, Fairfield.
My name's Liam, I'm from Mansfield, Massachusetts, marketing major with a minor in communications.
Excellent.
My name's Ben Danner, I'm from Waterville, Maine, I'm a finance major and entrepreneurship minor.
Okay, junior, senior?
I'm a junior.
Junior, okay, excellent.
Welcome. Well, I'll start out, my name's Joel French, I'm originally from Berwick, Maine. But I actually went to University of Maine, Orono, graduated back in 2004. I know I don't look that old. But I've been with Cintas now for coming up on 18 years. And actually found Cintas at an event kind of similar to this. It's ironic, I got an email one afternoon from Professor Strong, who was a finance professor of mine. And he said, hey, there's this kind of big up and coming company that's coming to the university to do an info session. They've got a great management trainee program. You should go check it out. So I did, and I guess the rest is history. So I'll go through a kind of a quick background on myself at Cintas since I joined, and feel free to ask any questions. With Cintas, like I said, I started out as a management trainee out of our facility down in Westbrook, Maine. And throughout the MT program, we'll go through kind of what that entails, but it was a two-year program for me. Following the program, I moved into an outside sales role with Cintas. I covered from Waterville up to Bangor, so I know this area pretty well. So I sold as a facility service rep for 2 years, which really means I sold all of our products that weren't uniforms. And then moved over to uniforms for a year, and after that, I kind of moved back to the operations side of our business and acted as a service manager. So oversaw a group of all of our route drivers that deliver the product and maintain the relationships with our customers. And for me at that point, it was really important to maintain those relationships as well, really to be there as their liaison to help grow the account, take care of any issues they had, et cetera. Following that, I was fortunate to move into a general manager spot in Westbrook, or what we call Portland. So I acted as the general manager in Portland for about another 7.5 years. During that time, we actually opened two new facilities for Cintas, one in Bow, New Hampshire, and then another one here in Bangor. So it's pretty cool to see that expansion and growth. And our Bangor facility is now doing really well under Kevin's leadership. So following my time as the general manager, I moved into a role as a sales director. And kind of what that means is I support all of our sales managers and sales reps that are out in the field, helping to train them, support them, helping them to sell, and then about 2.5 years ago, moved into the role as a training covering a larger geography where I cover now Eastern Canada and New England. So I've got locations from Windsor, Ontario, which is like just outside of Detroit, all the way to Halifax, and then all of New England plus one in New York as well. So it's been a pretty cool almost 18 years, kind of crazy to think. And just chatting with Taylor, I haven't been back to the university as much as I would like to, but still kind of feels normal. When I was getting in my truck this morning to drive up here, like I put the address in my GPS, and I'm like, tell me you've made this drive 100 times. So quickly canceled the GPS out and then just drove up. But I was fortunate to meet my wife here at UMaine. We've been married now for coming up on 17 years, been together for 20 years. Doesn't really seem right, but been together for 20 years. We've got two daughters, an 11, almost 12-year-old, Lila, and then Haley is 14. She'll be 15 in June, and is already planning on getting her permit and driving and all that scary stuff. So when I'm not working, we travel a lot as a family. We love to go to Florida. We were just talking about Florida. We just got back a couple days ago, so I know my tans or my suit doesn't show it, but nice to be down there and be warm. And the bottom left hand picture there, right before the pandemic started, actually it was about the same time, I went out to Arizona to run an ultra marathon out there in the desert. So that's what that was. Did that for some fun. I guess running for 10 or 12 hours is fun to some people. But really excited to be here with all of you today and talk about Cintas, but also just, you know, give any advice or answer any questions. You all are a pretty exciting time to think about kind of what's next after school and where you want to go. And I remember at that point, you know, you don't know a lot of the right things to look for, and we don't know all the answers, but between the four of us, we've got some experience that we can help out with if you'd like it. All right?
Thanks, Joel. Hi guys, my name is Kevin Wells. As Joel alluded to, I'm currently a general manager in Westbrook, Maine, Portland area. I also oversee the Bangor location as well. But I started my career in 2004, right out of college. I went to Siena College in Albany, New York. My goal was to play baseball. I went there on a baseball scholarship, and as I was graduating, I knew I was competitive. I knew I wanted to make money, and I didn't know much else outside of that. I wanted to get into business, but I didn't really know what that meant. And I stumbled across Cintas in a very similar scenario as Joel described. I didn't go to college to get into Cintas. I didn't know about the industry. I didn't even know the company existed. And I was in Washington, D.C., which is where I'm originally from. I grew up in Annapolis, Maryland. So when I graduated college, I was like, all right, I want to come back and get a career in the D.C. area, because that's, and I didn't know what that was, but I knew it was going to be something in business. And I remember interviewing with all types of life insurance companies, finance companies, selling sales products in finance, and then stumbled across Cintas and met this young lady, Tammy No, who was an HR manager, and she was an HR manager running the Washington, D.C. location HR department that had about 300 employees that worked at that department, and she was 28 years old. And I was very impressed with the amount of responsibility that she had at such a young age. And I was very impressed with, you know, looking at my friends and everyone else that had graduated college a couple years ahead of me and what they were doing, what their day-to-day and what their responsibilities looked like versus what she was telling me her responsibilities were and what her path was and what she had accomplished just, you know, being 2 or 3 years removed from graduating college. And that got me looking at Cintas. And of course, I did my due diligence, researched the company, and tried to make my own informed decision. But the more I studied the company and researched it, the more I liked it, the more I was intrigued by, hey, Cintas is behind the scenes helping other businesses prepare for their workday. We're a B2B company. We have the sixth largest fleet in the nation. So you think about the infrastructure and what that can mean, and then with the change of our new CEO, and I'll talk more about that later on, we're seeing technology come into this business like we never have before. And that really excites me for where we're going as a company, which we will talk more about. But my background, entered the Management Trainee Program, started in the Washington, D.C. location. I had the opportunity to then relocate with the company to Williamsburg, Virginia, to open up a branch down there just outside of the Virginia Beach area. Learned a ton with starting starting a business from the ground up. We had to hire everyone, we had to train everyone, we had to build the rail system, build the building. So I was involved in the ground level, while in the MT program, helping with this, build and training and development of this location. Upon graduating the program, going to Williamsburg, I then got an opportunity to move back to, Washington DC, but the suburbs on the Northern Virginia side. So Manassas, Virginia, if anybody's familiar with it, it's basically a suburb of Washington DC, Northern Virginia. We had an opportunity to open a branch there as well. This would be my second time being involved with opening a branch in a location. Still not the leader, but again, wanted to be part of the learning experience. And at the time, personally, I was dating a girl who is now my wife, but she was in Annapolis and we had a long distance, relationship and commute, so it made sense. I was like, hey, love the company, love the experience, love everything I'm seeing. I want to be closer to the next step of my personal life. And Cintas allowed me to do that, allowed me to get a little bit closer to Annapolis. And we grew that location from 10 routes to 30 routes in 2 years, and became the fastest growing branch in the company, which put a spotlight on me, put a spotlight on my boss at the time, and opened up a lot of doors and opportunities within Cintas. At that time, my wife and I got engaged, and I moved in with her, and I was in Annapolis, Maryland, and I was commuting back and forth. If anybody knows the DC Beltway, or what traffic could be like around Washington, DC, we think it's bad in Boston, we think it's bad in New York. I'd argue Washington, D.C.'s got some of the worst traffic in the country. So I was commuting 2.5 hours each way, 5 hours in traffic, working a 10-hour day in operations. And it's like, hey, I love the company, but something's got to give. It's, can I transfer? I went to my boss, and I was getting great results for him, and said, hey, you know, I love it. I don't want to leave. I don't want to look elsewhere, but something's got to give. So he said, instead of transferring, and he let me interview, he let me make my own decisions. I interviewed in Baltimore, and I thought about transferring to that location. He said, why don't you give sales a try and go in and be a sales rep. You can lower your RPMs a little bit. You don't have to be physically in the building as much as you do in operations. And everything that I had learned thus far through the management trainee program, through my operational experience, I just had to learn how to prospect. I didn't need to learn the company's culture. I had built my brand up already as a leader, so the partners I worked with knew who I was. I had a bit of reputation in the marketplace already. I didn't have to learn our products. I didn't have to learn our pricing. I just had to learn how to prospect. So very quickly, I had tremendous success in sales. My first year, I was a President's Club rep, top 15% in the company. I got Rookie of the Year in the Mid-Atlantic region, and was like, hey, I found sales. Like, this is it. I wish I would have done it sooner. This is the job for me. Then my boss gets promoted, and he goes up to Boston, and he calls me about 3 months later and says, hey, Kev, I know you love sales. I know you're making more money than you ever have. I know you have the best work-life balance you've ever had, and I know you just got married, but I need your help. I'm struggling up here in Boston. It's a much bigger location. There's some cultural problems. And would you be willing to relocate and come up here and help me out in Boston? And he paid me to do it. But I said, yeah, I trust you, and really never been to New England, never been to Boston before, blindly trusted in a leader that I'd worked with for about 5 to 6 years at this point on an opportunity and knowing the company. Went up there and helped him as an operations manager, which is basically a general manager for everything that was not uniform related. Basically ran all of the facility service business in the Boston market. We had the third highest growth in the company in the facility service under my leadership in 1 year. And then that gave me an opportunity when our sales force, our new business sales force, was underperforming. The sales manager was removed from the position he was in. We were behind projections. And they said, hey, you've executed in sales and you've executed in leadership. Why not take a shot at sales leadership? We'd like to have you interview for the position. I got the position from an ops manager to a sales manager. At the time, I said it was an underperforming sales team. We had one rep qualify for President's Club. What I'm very proud of is by the time I left that sales manager job, we were the number one sales team in the company in 4 years. And we took every rep except for two reps to President's Club. President's Club, you have a trip. We went to Cancun or something at the time. So we're walking around Cancun with our CEO, CFO, COO, all the executives, and I have 18 reps with their significant others, with me and my wife. So it's just a spotlight of who are these 40 people that are all walking around. number one sales team in the company, and that gave me even more of a platform for opportunity. And because of that growth, we had to open up another branch in the Boston area. And the decision was made to open up a branch in Worcester, Massachusetts. And this time, I was given the keys to the building, and they said, hey, because of the growth that your sales team has done, and because of what you've been involved with in the past of opening these branches, we'd like you to run this branch. So I became the branch manager in Worcester. Year one, we opened it. Year two, we got the Outstanding Achievement Award, which is an achievement of excellence within our operating of the company. Growth and profit exceeding 35%, so it was a good sign that we were off to a good start in Worcester, Massachusetts. And I thought, hey, I love Worcester, this is great. Then we bought one of our biggest competitors, G&K Services. And when we bought G&K Services, they had a plant in Manchester, New Hampshire. And Joel had alluded to Bow, New Hampshire being a small branch that we had opened up. And Bow, New Hampshire, Manchester, New Hampshire, about 20 minutes apart from each other. So when we bought and we had to acquire this company and integrate the cultures, the decision was also made to close the branch in Bow and move all of those partners 20 minutes over to the plant with the G&K, and we'll just change the name to Cintas, and everything will go according to plan moving forward. Obviously, integrations, acquisitions, there's certainly some challenges with that, and there we struggled a little bit. It was, this is how we do things at Cintas versus this is how we do things in this building, because we were the G&K leadership, that was their building, so it was almost a little backwards, and it was a bit of a toxic culture, and I was called in to help and assist with that. I took the responsibility and the assignment. I was able to promote somebody to backfill my position in Worcester. I then came into the Manchester assignment. We cleaned that location up in about 2 years. Had great results. We were humming. Our KPIs were looking good. Very satisfied with the future of New Hampshire and Manchester. And then COVID-19 hits. COVID-19 hits, and we see some of our revenues just drop overnight, and some adjustments had been made. I had worked for Cintas for 15 years. At no point have I ever seen any downsizing, layoffs, reduction in forces. It was always growth after growth after growth. COVID-19, we made it through, and we're in a very strong position, but because of that drop in revenue, the decision was made we need to close some older plants and older facilities across the country. And the newer acquisition was a plant from 1941 that had been through two or three other acquisitions. So we decided we're gonna close your plant, Kevin, and you have to deliver the news to those partners. And that was one of the toughest assignments I've ever had in my life, to look partners in the eyes and tell them that I need them. They're essential workforce now, but once we close in 60 days, you're no longer essential. And I took it personally. I made sure that everyone got good severance packages. And then if I wasn't able to retain or keep anyone, I personally made sure we were able to place every one of those employees. And I'm happy to say I was able to do that and to do that with care and take care of those partners in a very tough situation meant a lot to me. And I learned a lot from that experience and a lot about business and people through that experience. So then when we closed that plant, the decision was made that we're gonna now wash and dry the laundry of the clothes in Portland, Maine, and we're gonna shuttle that volume back and forth on an 18-wheeler. That's how branches and plants work. And the volume change in capacity was a challenge for the current general manager at the time, and he was removed from his position, and it gave me an opportunity to then become the general manager in Portland, Maine, and that's where I am right now. So my career, in a nutshell, over the last 18 years. I'll turn it over to our third presenter and MT, Julie.
All right. Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Julie Barakas. I am a senior HR manager out of our location in, we call it Westbrook or Portland. It's the same place. Most people know Portland, so we tend to call it that. I'm going to say basically what's a bad word in this room. University of New Hampshire is where I graduated from several years ago, so don't throw anything at me.
I've learned a lot about this rivalry.
Yeah, so... But hey, I'm still happy to be recruiting at University of Maine. But I learned about Cintas in a very similar fashion to Joel and Kevin. They were on campus. I joined a information session they were putting on, and the rest is kind of history at this point. But I started as an intern. So I did a summer internship locations, and I worked alongside Joel for a lot of years, helping out with that and staffing those locations, and now I'm a senior HR manager, so I support several different Cintas locations in the New England market and work alongside with our HR director for the region on a lot of different HR tasks and responsibilities. So I'll keep mine kind of short so we can keep everything going here. I'll let Jake introduce himself. He is a last minute addition, so he doesn't have a slide for you guys to see, but we'll let him introduce himself so you all know who he is.
Hi everyone, my name is Jake. I'm currently a service manager here with Cintas. Graduated from the University of Maine about 4 years ago. So I literally remember sitting in your seats and hearing these speeches as well. Came in as a trainee with Cintas upon graduating from the University of Maine. Once I completed my rotation as a trainee, I became a service supervisor. So basically I assisted in overseeing our drivers who go out and deliver the products to our customers. Since then, about a year ago, I've been promoted to a service manager. So now I not only oversee the drivers who go out to our customers, but I also oversee a book of business where I make higher end decisions on what we're going to do with our current customer base. So I'm really enjoying Cintas. Cintas is a great company. Speaking with somebody that is having recently graduated, I would say my best advice to kind of give you guys is to get out in front of what you're going to do with your careers. Don't let yourself graduate and not know what you're going to do. Try to gain internships before you graduate. Try to know exactly what you're going to do to get out in front of it. Everybody graduates around the same time when you're in college, obviously. So everybody's competing for those roles. So it's a great opportunity to get out in front of it and just kind of know what you're doing. So, that being said, turn it back over.
You going to start out?
I can. You want me to, or you want to go?
Yeah.
All right. So just a little history on our company. Cintas started kind of out of necessity. It was founded by Doc and Amelia Farmer, who were actually circus performers. And Amelia was a trapeze artist in the circus, and Doc was a bare-knuckle brawler in the circus. And that was the careers they had out for themselves in the 20s. And then something called the Great Recession hit. When the Great Recession hit, obviously people no longer had discretionary income. And they're not going to the circus, so the circus was disbanded, and Doc and Amelia found themselves out of a job and having to be creative to carve out a living for themselves. At that time, they realized that there was a need around machine shops for having these rags that were just used for dipsticks and oil and grease and just discarded. And they thought, hey, maybe we can go pick up these rags, launder them, and return them to the customers and create a nominal living for ourselves out of that. And they did just that. They created a Acme Wiper Company around the Dayton, Ohio area and had one small business that really focused on soil protection and rags in the Great Depression. And then when Doc and Amelia's son went to college and graduated college, Dick Farmer, Dick came out of college and said, hey, I want to join the family company, but I'm a little bit more ambitious. And Doc and Amelia were hesitant because they were Depression era and thought, hey, just be good with what we have. Let's not get too greedy here. I don't know if I believe in, you know, risking all of this and being so hungry for additional money, additional revenue. So they were kind of resistant, and eventually they were worn down, and Dick was able to take control of the company as his family retired. They grew it into more of a regional business. They changed it to Satellite Uniform Company, and they expanded their offering from just rags to some coveralls that they could wear for soil protection, some fender covers, but still very limited product offering, almost like a regional dry cleaner would be, but just the focus on those product offerings. As the company evolved and Dick got more established with the company and thought, I want to grow and I want to continue to grow, Dick's son Scott joined the company. And Dick's son Scott Farmer joined in the mid-80s, but Dick was the one that took the company public. And in 1981, we had our first initial public offering, and they listed it on the NASDAQ. And the stock price was probably $12 a share or somewhere in that range, which was, we've come a long way since then. But when Scott graduated and joined the company, this is when Dick said, okay, now we need to put a system. We're getting to be a big corporation at this point. We're no longer a regional company, we're publicly traded. Let's design a program to groom future executives. So Scott Farmer was the first management trainee at Cintas, and the son of Dick Farmer, and our CEO who just retired a year ago. And now our new CEO, Todd Schneider, is the first CEO we've had in quite some time that does not have the Farmer last name. But again, I'm very excited. He's been with the company for his entire career as well. He's brought up in the company. He was on the board of directors, so I don't see a lot changing other than the story's replaying itself a little bit. We're very aggressive, and Todd is very bullish on growth, bullish on the future, bullish on bringing technology into our business and taking us into the next chapter of what the Cintas story will be. Some of the things that happened later, 2018, 2019, that really set us up for success, is we have some very exclusive partnerships that have allowed us to get a stronger hold on the marketplace. One of them is Carhartt. We're had the exclusive rental car contract with Carhartt. And a lot of you all probably know that brand name. They design uniforms for Cintas that are designed to hold up in industrial washing machines, but have that Carhartt label. So what that means is a lot of people would spend their own money retail on a Carhartt product. You would go to the Carhartt retail store, you could buy that tan jacket for $150 at the store. Or you can add it to your uniform program through Cintas. We can put your company logo on it, and you can rent it for $1.50 a week. If it wears out, needs to be replaced, you need a size change, you need to be upgraded, we'll take care of all of that. So we've revolutionized what a uniform looks like. It used to be candy stripes, gas station attendants, soil protection, and now we have retail-inspired co-branded. ChefWorks is another example similar to Carhartt. We've partnered with ChefWorks. We have the exclusive contract with ChefWorks as well for culinary apparel. And then the last thing that's on here is our Ryder Cup sponsorship. And I don't know if any of you watch the Ryder Cup, but Cintas is the premier sponsor of the Ryder Cup right now. We've been for the last 3 to 4 years. And that gets me excited about international expansion. We've grown to be the largest in North America, but we're just scratching the surface on markets similar to ours, like Europe and some other places. So as we talk through this presentation, I think you're gonna see a lot of excitement, a lot of momentum of what Cintas has done and the opportunities we've had. But I don't want you to think that you're missing the boat on this. We have a long way to go, and we have a lot of levers to pull for the future. And what was a $2.4 billion company when I started, it's now a $7.5 billion company, and we're just getting going, and that's created tremendous opportunity for Joel, me, Julie, and countless others, and hopefully you all in this room as well.
And Jake, too.
Yeah.
So we'll go through the next few slides a little bit quicker, but please feel free. Like, if you got a question or comment, you know, raise your hand, just speak up. It's a small group. A couple of achievements here just to point out, and I want to just really reference one in particular. Fortune just named Cintas to their most admired companies list again. And this is actually the 14th time that we've been on this list. And you know, there's a lot of great accomplishments on the screen, a lot of stuff that Kevin talked about. But for us, having financial success is important, but being recognized as one of those most admired companies amongst some of the best in the world is really important, because it means that, you know, we do the right thing and we take care of our employees that we call partners. You've heard Kevin and I say that a few times. And that the trajectory for the future looks really, really good as well. So we're gonna walk you through some pieces of the management trainee program, what some career paths can look like, because I think it gives you a pretty good picture into, hey, what options are out there? Because there's not like a one size fits all answer for anybody. You know, you go to a business school and you get a marketing degree or a management degree or a finance degree, like, what do I want to do after that? That means a lot of different things, you know, for a lot of different people. And one of the cool things about Cintas is you can experience a lot of those things and start to figure out what you like and what you don't like and what you're good at, maybe what you're not quite as good at, so that you can fine-tune that career path a little bit better, okay?
So we've recently celebrated over 1 million customers at Cintas, and we had our 1 millionth customer probably 8 years ago at this point. I think it's an outdated slide, but that was a big deal when we reached our 1 millionth customer. Like I said, we've grown as a company. We finished 2020 at $7.08 billion. When I started, it was $24. When I started, the stock price was $24, and our revenue was $2.4 billion. And it's now 7.8. I think we're going to finish at $7.5 billion by the end of this fiscal year as we continue to climb out of COVID-19. We have the sixth largest fleet, like I said, and we have almost 15,000 trucks on the road at any given time. So you just think about that infrastructure and how we can grow for diversified outsourcing with specialization in our customers' needs. And that's where our business model is today, with 5 manufacturing facilities and 12 distribution centers within the United States.
Yeah, and one thing just to point out too before I hop into this one, as part of kind of our mission as a company, our now CEO has kind of outlined a few priorities, but two in particular. And one of those is that we want to continue to grow the company at a rate that allows us to double in size every 10 years or less. And so you start to think about that, and Kevin mentioned earlier, you know, it's tripled in size since he joined, similar for myself. And you take a $7 billion company and make it a $14 billion company in 10 years. What that means for opportunity is pretty exciting stuff. So, Julie, you can go ahead and click through. So the Management Trainee Program, we've all touched on this a little bit. What is it all about? Our Management Trainee Program is a 21-month program where you go through a rotation in each of our primary departments. So I mentioned earlier that career paths look very different. And you know, for me in school, I was a finance major, but I knew I wanted to get into some type of leadership position. And so you think about, like, hey, I want to be in leadership. I want to be a manager. Well, what type? And that's different, not only for every organization, but even just in like a microscope, looking at Cintas, being a production manager or a service manager or a sales manager or an HR manager are all very different jobs. And so you come out of college and it's like, I want to get leadership, but I don't really know what. So you stumble your way through for a while trying to figure that out, trying to find the right company. And at Cintas, we realized that, hey, this program gives you a chance to learn all these. So these rotations, they're not just job shadows. You're given leadership roles where you're a supervisor or otherwise in that department to not only learn the department, but to learn that type of leadership and work with the partners and understand the business from all levels so that you kind of get a leg up on your career. And, you know, I don't tell people that weren't MTs that we have a leg up on them, but we have a leg up on them because we know the whole business. We did it all. So once you finish the MT program, we'll kind of give you a graph here. But the idea is that you move into an outside sales rep role following the management training program because one of the things that's also very important to us is understanding that sales acumen, understanding why prospects, why customers buy from Cintas, why would they choose to do business with us over an alternative. And having that sales skill set is important in every role. Whether you're in a sales job or you're in production leadership, you still have to sometimes sell an idea to a group of people. So we realize that fundamental sales success is important. So every single management trainee goes into sales following your program for at least a year to just get in there and learn it. Now, if you don't love sales, that's okay. That's not a bad thing. But you understand how to be successful. We'll talk a little bit about what a sales rep can make for money because, you know, money's cool. Right? It's not the only reason we go to work, but it's a good one. And so as a performing sales rep, you can certainly do really well financially as well. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Can you go back to that last slide?
Yeah.
So you mentioned
this one?
That, no, the one that Joel was just talking about. You mentioned that you were doing the management trainee. Do you, after that, you become a field intern or sales intern, or?
No, that's a step before. So a field intern is you're still in college. So if you were looking for an internship, the idea for an internship is you can get in with us because it's a very selective group. I usually hire one MT a year for my region. New England looks to hire, you know, 4 or 5 MTs for the entire region. So it's a very selective group. And part of the way to get into the program is to intern with us prior to graduating school to then go on and join the program. So that's a step we didn't talk about. But if you're juniors right now and you're thinking about getting in with Cintas, take one of my cards, let me know, and if you're looking for an internship, we have those opportunities as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's a good question. And you know, with kind of this trajectory, you know, it really kind of, it's pretty defined to this point, to the sales rep level. You know, going through the management training program, your fourth rotation, your fourth department is sales. So you finish the program in sales, and then you move into that outside sales rep role. And then after that, there's a lot of career paths you can take that we'll kind of touch on and show you. And you saw, you know, the four of ours. They're not all the same, which is nice because, hey, sometimes with companies you get a little bit siloed and, hey, if you're in sales, you stay in sales. And that's not necessarily where somebody wants to spend their entire career. Career's a long time.
So, Selling Power magazine, I don't know if anybody's heard of this. I certainly didn't hear about it until I got into the sales world. Has anybody heard of Selling Power magazine? Basically ranks the best companies to sell for in each industry. And it's they send out a list every single year. And the three areas they really look at for their criteria of ranking these companies is the training that's available to you, the upward mobility with performance, you know, is there promotability opportunities, and then the overall compensation that's available to you in those rankings. In the service industries, where Cintas would fall under that list, and we always fall in the top 10 year after year after year. I think we placed seventh last time. Is that where we are this year?
Yeah.
So we finished seventh overall, but we're number one in compensation, which I think is very important when we're talking about that. So if you're looking for get in with a company where you, as you get results, you're going to be recognized and rewarded with more opportunity, and continue to get paid more, Cintas is something I would seriously take a look at for your careers.
So we wanted to give you all a little bit of a picture as to what we do. We've kind of touched on some of these terms with uniforms and facility services. And, you know, again, before I joined Cintas, I had no idea what the company was. I think Julie said the same thing. And what it was when we joined and what it is today are really two different things in terms of our product offering. But our goal is to support our customers with all the services, all the products they need to run their business. And it's continued to expand that way. So we say things like facility services, but really that means everything from products to clean the facility, soap and paper towels, hand sanitizer, which you can imagine was pretty darn popular over the last 2 years, things like entrance matting, a lot of products that as just a normal consumer or somebody walking into a business, you don't even necessarily recognize. You know, for all of you, and certainly for me, if I went into a restaurant when I was in college, I didn't think about, geez, there's a mat on the floor that's collecting dirt and, like, what happens with that? But that's the kind of stuff that we do for these businesses. And why that's pretty neat is it means that we work with every single industry. So as you go through economic ups and downs, certain industries, they get hurt. You know, and COVID was certainly one of those that played a big role in impacting businesses. Well, Cintas, since we work with every industry, if one starts to go down a little bit, hospitality as an example throughout COVID went down, well, things like healthcare, which are also a big industry for us, go up. And so I tell you that because throughout COVID, we still grew as a company, which a lot of organizations can't say. And it's pretty neat to work with every single type of business that's out there. And so we've got a million customers right now, but depending on the estimate that you look at, there's somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 million businesses in North America. And so we're the number one company in the industry and we only have a million. So there's a pretty good runway for where we go from here, right? And then as we continue to introduce new products, whether that's on the garment side of our business or what we call uniforms and stretch into different industries, but we start to kind of expand out even more. And you know, certainly we work with a lot of small businesses, but you think about some larger ones like Marriott Hotels. Well, every Marriott employee in the world wears a Cintas uniform. Southwest Airlines, every single Southwest Airlines employee in the world wears a Cintas uniform. So those really large brands are some customers for us. And then certainly you get into, you know, if you've got a smaller business, we can help them out too. And those branded partnerships, Kevin touched on Carhartt and ChefWorks, things like North Face, they're brands that people like. Like, we all probably wear that stuff in our personal lives, but we can get it through a Cintas program and take care of it for them. So it's pretty neat to think about what the opportunities look like.
Do you do any of, like, the cleaning, or is it just supplies that you're replenishing?
Yeah, great question. So you can answer that question in two ways. So number one, yes, we do offer some cleaning services as well. So we offer some deep clean services and some sanitation services that we've introduced since COVID, where we go in and like spray everything with a disinfectant. We've got a cleaning service that'll go in and clean kitchens, clean bathrooms. clean, you know, locker rooms, things like that. But also all of our products that aren't disposable that we offer. So let's say, you know, the University of Maine, which is a new large customer of ours for entrance mats, we supply all those entrance mats to them, and then every week a Cintas truck pulls up, takes that dirty mat out and places down a clean one. We bring the dirty one back to our facility, we launder it, and then that continues on that cycle every week. So we are collecting revenue from our customers weekly, you know, and so it starts to really help out our business as we grow. So it, hopefully that answers your question. We kind of do both.
Definitely.
And then Cintas as a company, sorry, Julie, you're good. We also offer two other divisions. All of us work in what's called the rental division, which is those products that I touched on. But we have a division in first aid and safety products, which is everything from cabinets to defibrillators to training and supplies there, as well as fire protection. So that's extinguishers, suppression systems, sprinklers, all that kind of stuff as well. So we start to spread out so that, again, we can truly cover everything within our customers.
Yeah, and I think this is another thing. Upon graduation, when you enter into the sales organization, and you heard me talk about in my career, and I'm very fond, and I wish I would have had sales experience sooner, because I think sales really helped me develop as a business professional. To Joel's point of everything you do as far as selling ideas to my team internally, selling ideas to my vice president and bosses above me, influencing people around me, in addition to customer interaction, prospect interaction, partner interaction, all of that was stuff that I learned in sales, and I never labeled myself as a sales guy. I thought I didn't want to go into sales, and you know, I got comfortable being uncomfortable, and I understood I loved sales. And when you graduate, a lot of times if you're not sales-minded, there's some anxiety of like, okay, am I going to have to go sell now? What does that look like? And I want you to know, Cintas has got you. I talked about Selling Power magazine and how we rank number one for compensation, but we're always in the top 10. We have a very extensive training program, and we'll teach you everything, but what you've learned in the program gives you a leg up. And I constantly, myself included, Joel included, MTs come in and enter our sales organization, and their trajectory just takes off over outside hires or people that are already with the organization because of what they understand. When you graduate the program, there's a very extensive 12-week training program that's going to show you how to prospect. What are the activities, what are the inputs that you need to do that are going to lead to the result that you want to achieve? And I think that's the disconnect a lot of times in sales, is we all want to get the result, but we don't quite understand what the inputs are and what we have to do on a daily basis to prospect to bring that business in. And this training guide, called Training Guide 18, just outlines day by day what your activities will be doing, what you'll be doing for the week with some milestone accomplishments, and then a certification process after the fact that Joel spends a lot of time doing in his current role, traveling and certifying reps across the country and Canada as well. Another thing that I love that our company does is as we've grown to be this $7.8 billion corporation, communication is become more and more important. The bigger your company gets, the easier it is to lose things in the weeds directionally. And Cintas puts out podcasts every single week from our top executives doing interviews, explaining the why behind things, and we could all have the app on our phone and listen to our CEO and listen to what's going on and his perspective of it. And I just found that that's helped me out so much in a growing organization to understand the why directly from our top executives when I'm out in the field, because that was always my frustration, is I just want to be informed with what's going on, and when I'm misinformed or I don't understand the decision-making process in a big corporation, That would irk me from time to time. And Cintas has handled that, they've recognized that, and they put together this weekly podcast system with top leaders to inform us all as we're continuing to be developed. So, yes, sir.
I'm wondering, so you say there's a lot of communications to top executives, and this is started out as a family business, so is that kind of where the culture is today? As far as, you know, you guys all seem well acquainted. Is that how it is throughout the company?
Yes, I would say in the MT program, it became a fraternity, really, if I could think of a most appropriate word for it. You know, you get this badge of honor of your instant credibility. You're in the MT program. When you're introduced, this is so-and-so management trainee for us. It's like, wow, all right, this guy got the job, old girl got the job, this person got the job. So they're gonna be high potential for us. And what I loved about my experience as an MT was my first year, they flew me out to corporate for Core Course 1. It was a week-long training program, and I got to meet management trainees in my class from all over the country. We networked, we exchanged business cards, it was great. But as we progressed over the years, I would start to see these faces over and over and over again, and we'd always reconnect at different times. When we'd go on President's Club trips, I'd see, you know, the rep that was an MT with me 8 years ago, and I met his new wife, and they've met my wife, and we're hanging out together. So yes, it starts off with your class, but then as you start to grow in your careers, you're always a management trainee, you've been groomed, you've been developed, and you're the cream of the crop, so you start to cross paths constantly. And that's where me starting in Washington, D.C., Joel starting up here, it seems like we have a great relationship. We talk constantly, and I have no problem picking up the phone out of the blue, calling him if I need something, him calling me, and I have that relationship across the entire country and in Canada because of my 20 years with this company and my brand as a management trainee. Yes, sir.
Did you notice any challenges throughout the pandemic, like with the training program, like the differences, like online and in person?
Yeah. The pandemic had a ton of challenges, and I was very impressed with how Cintas responded to those challenges, because quite frankly, there were days where I just looked out the window like, what's going on? All the rules have changed. I don't understand. I can't bring people in my building. We have to wear masks. It's hard to recruit. I mean, I was recruiting for a computer screen. So we jumped on Microsoft Teams. We learned technology very, very quickly. We pivoted in a million different ways to still run a business in a very different business climate than we'd ever seen possible. So I think Cintas handled it very well, but the amount of change for a big company in a short period of time, I was very impressed with how we responded to the outside challenges we were faced with.
Thank you.
Yeah, you got it.
Next slide.
1 o'clock, are we good just to wrap it up, or a few more minutes?
So does anybody here have a class starting right now?
I gotta take off for work in a little bit, but I can hang around for
okay.
A few more minutes.
Yeah, we can talk a little bit more, and if you guys have questions, keep chiming in. Because I want you to understand what the opportunity is here. And then if you have to go to class or if you have to go to work, I think it's fine, just get up and go. I have business cards here. We all have business cards here. I'll put them in the back of the room in case anybody wants to grab them and discreetly walk out at the time, but we're gonna keep going.
Yeah, and I'll touch on this one quickly, and it kind of speaks to your point about communication. One of the things is there's a formalized process to help that as well. And you know, to point to our mentor program, so every single partner that comes into sales or management training gets assigned a mentor. And so what's nice about this is it starts that communication, starts to build that relationship. And you know, I could probably talk for another hour on how mentors that I've had throughout my career at Cintas have helped me to kind of make decisions and go throughout. But more importantly, you start to build bonds and forge relationships so that in a company of 40,000 employees, it still feels like a small company. You know, I'm fortunate, I know Kevin is too, that people like our CEO, our president, our senior vice presidents, I've either worked directly with them or indirectly through mentor relationships that, you know, I could get on a plane and fly to our corporate office tomorrow and they would know who I am and I know who they are. And we could have just a normal conversation, which doesn't happen in a lot of big organizations, a lot of Fortune 500 companies where that's the case. And it's purposeful through, you know, whether it's a mentorship program or just how we help each other develop. So I'll touch on this one and then Kevin, please add in.
Mm-hmm.
Touch on like all the different career paths. And we use the terminology like a career jungle gym. And so this slide kind of talks through what some of those different career paths can look like. Because again, I think it's important to know, hey, you want to join a company that you can do more and you can advance your career, and what are those different jobs that could be available. And so this one speaks to our service leadership, sales leadership, and then what we call enterprise sales, which enterprise sales for us is more of our large national customers and some certain segments, such as education, healthcare, government. We have to have specialized people that learn those. But what's great is you can come in as a management trainee and go into sales, and then maybe you decide, hey, I want to go be a service manager and work up through operations, general manager, and so on. Or you want to go to enterprise sales and be a major account manager and just work with the largest hospitals or largest universities in your territory, or you want to go back and forth, which some of us have done in our careers. So it's just nice to know that you've got a good runway and you can certainly bounce around and do more. And I would urge all of you, whether you choose to look more at Cintas or another company, get an understanding of what career paths can look like. Because in some organizations, there might only be two or three steps that you can go in your career. And if you work for 20, 25, 30 years, you want to know that you can do more. You know, you can be challenged, learn different things, and you're not just waiting for that one guy or girl to retire in 20 years. That, hey, can I continue to advance my career regardless of what other people do, but more based on what you do?
Yeah, and I'd say the big thing with that slide is as I grew up in Cintas, it was always a ladder that you could climb. And as we've grown as a company, it's become more of a lattice where you can go back and forth. And myself and Joel and even Julie, we've had multiple careers with the same company. I've worked in different markets, in Virginia, DC, Boston, Maine, all very different places, New Hampshire, operations, sales, but I'm able to contribute to my same 401k. I'm able to continue to build equity within my company as I'm rewarded with stock as the company grows and I do well, but based off of my performance. So people that I interview, and now I have the luxury to interview lots of people and talk to people, why are they switching? Why are they looking for other opportunities? And it's just that, they don't see the vision of where I go from here. The boss ahead of me has been there, he's not gonna retire for 15 years. I just don't know where I need to go, so I'm looking elsewhere. Anytime I thought I got complacent in my job and needed to be challenged, Cintas came to me with an opportunity. Anytime I thought I needed to make more money, Cintas came to me with an opportunity. And I told you the opportunities I said yes to. I didn't tell you the opportunities I said no to. So to me, one of the biggest selling points of our company is the opportunity that you will have as you get results. One of the biggest challenges we have being a growing company is being able to groom people who are ready to take on leadership responsibilities quick enough to keep up with our growth. Because we can actually grow too fast, or it could be a detriment to the marketplace. And I love the fact that our company has a culture of developing people to go on and do more and grow within the company, as opposed to hiring talent from the outside. I can say I can go out and find somebody who has an MBA and can read a profit and loss statement and understand that. It takes a whole different skill set to win the hearts and minds of frontline workers to care about the profit and loss and have discretionary effort. And that's what the MT program has taught me, is I can work for a big corporation, have empathy for the challenges of my frontline partners because I've grown up in the company and been developed through the company, and get them to really desire to improve because I can lead in a way that gets them excited because I understand the job, not just the corporate design or the profit and loss statement, but how do you engage partners to care? And that's what the program, a part of what the program has given me and Joel.
So we do like to touch on some of what we call our PBRGs, or partner-based resource groups, and it's just, again, another opportunity for Cintas to bring people together based on your differences, your backgrounds, kind of where you come from, what's important to you. And so some of these here are just a highlight of that. And we wanted to take a formalized approach to this so that, hey, we can help people feel welcome, and we certainly value diversity. We know it's very important. And, you know, that diverse thought helps us to continue to grow and advance as a company.
We give back a lot, too, and I think it's very important. We have a brand, we have a reputation, and we have a responsibility. And these are a lot of the national things. But one of the events that really struck a chord with me, with the power of giving back and the power of community, I was at a sales leadership conference that we had in Foxwoods casinos in Connecticut, big casino area, and we had all of our sales reps from all the regions, probably five years ago, pre-COVID, and we brought everybody in, and we had a team building exercise where you had to partner up with groups of four with reps from other parts of the region and assemble whatever the project was in this box. So we open up the box, we try to figure out what it is. It's a bunch of bike parts. We assemble all of these bicycles and we have some fun. We think it's competitive. We're, you know, who's gonna win? Who's gonna get it done first? Who's gonna get it done right? It took about 4 hours because we didn't have instructions, but we got through the team build part of that and thought, okay, we built these bikes. Then my vice president got up on stage and said, all right, who are the winners? Here's what's going on. Now here are the real winners. And opened up a curtain to a back room, and it was all underprivileged youth that had an opportunity to pick out their new bicycle. And that was just chills. Talking about it today with you all still gives me chills. How I felt about that, looking at the kids and what that impact made. So I just want you to know, as Cintas is a great company, we give back at a national level and we give back at a local level. And I try to do a team building event to give back at least once a quarter, where we'll do a Habitat for Humanity, or we'll go work at a soup kitchen, or we'll do a Christmas present drive around the holidays, whatever it is, because that's important.
So we've recently made a statement to become net zero emissions by 2050. And you know, I think as any company, being able to be a good steward of the environment is very important as well. And you can imagine a company like Cintas, where we have the sixth largest fleet, where we run these large industrial laundry facilities. To get to that point is going to be a big undertaking, but for us it's really important part of the journey. You know, just being a good member of our communities and taking care of the environment that we all work in. So just wanted to touch on that quickly. There's certainly a lot more that we could go into at a later date with everybody, but we're real proud of that statement, and certainly looking forward to what that does for the organization as we move forward.
And then outside of compensation and other benefits that Cintas has to offer, and we talk about salary, you talk about commissions, we talk about how we've been ranked in Selling Power magazine. But upon graduation, you would also receive a cell phone allowance as part of the program. We also cover your car. So we ask that you have a car no older than 10 years old. So if you have a car older than that, you'd have to upgrade your car, because we're an image company and we want to represent a successful image. But Cintas will cover your car, we'll cover your gas as well, and we'll also cover your car insurance. And you can cancel your insurance and come on our insurance as well, as being a sales rep on our team. It's also benefits, or I didn't recognize it at the time. Now I have two kids, 10 and 7, and it feels like we're always going to the doctor's office or the hospital for something. But our benefit packages are very, very strong. And most of you will probably still be on your parents' benefits for a number of years, as I was. But once I had my first child, it really hit home how great the benefits are at Cintas. And we do a lot of things to keep our prices down so that we can give the best benefits to our employees. One of those things that we have is a voluntary sign up for an annual biometric screening program, where we'll come in and do your blood work if you so want to. And if you do that and show that you're healthy, you can get a lower rate on your insurance premium. So now that I've done this, and I talk to my wife and I talk to other peers and neighbors, we have one of the stronger benefit packages that I've ever seen. And Cintas is very competitive about that. Also, being a large company, there's lots of partner perks. So it's almost like having a AAA membership. You talk about Marriott or National Accounts, Verizon. We have corporate relationships with all of those companies that get you discounts on your hotel stays, get you discounts on your airline travel, or get you discount on food or theme parks or whatever it is. Cintas has got an app you can put on your phone, and wherever you go, just check it, and there's almost always a discount for being a partner of Cintas and an employee of our corporation. Our 401k is also very strong, and this was something I certainly encourage all of you to do. I took advantage of it when I was very young. My parents were both small business owners and did not invest in a 401k. So as soon as I entered the MT program, I lived at home for my first year. I put almost 50% of my salary into my 401k, and I certainly can't do that now. But it gave me a leg up, and I got ahead, and Cintas matches up to 10% in your 401k, which is also very, very powerful, and it's helped me obtain some long-term wealth. When I see it now, 18 years staying with the same company, contribute to a 401k that I'm fully vested in, with that employee match has helped. We also have employee stock ownership programs and a profit sharing program as well, based off of your results. So again, a big thing I would look at if you're looking at any companies is, hey, is there any ownership stake in the performance of the company? When I do well and the company does well, can I get any equity in the company? And in Cintas and in sales and in leadership, and the further you move up in the company and the longer your tenure is, the more equity you get in your comp plan, which is also very lucrative. And I just advise in general, look at that when looking at companies if
pretty cool perk, you know, as a sales partner or even now a service partner, there's a performance level that you can attain where you get to go on a nice trip. Trip for you and a guest, somewhere tropical and warm. They're not in Maine, although Maine's beautiful, especially in the summer. The water does not look like that, so it's always somewhere pretty cool. And it's a nice place just to connect and get recognized and meet some other people. And certainly every year going to President's Club, you get to see people from another part of the country or internationally that you haven't seen in a while, and celebrate your success together.
And then we have fun. There's a lot of recognition. This is a lot of the New England, this is all the New England market and our teams. And Joel, these are a lot of your slides, but I've done all of these events with my sales team. I can see the Q4 Summit dinner for peak performing members that we went to Peaks Island. I remember being a part of that. That was a lot of fun. I think we had a dinner at Del Fresco's in the Seaport in Boston with our high performers in that bottom picture. Brendan St. Peter is another sales director. It's at Fenway Park with Joel up there as well. Ski trips, I believe that's Castle Island in Southie in the bottom right, where we did a disabled American veteran 5K run with our families to give back and have some fun. So there's always something going on. Work hard, play hard, but you will be recognized and have a lot of fun with our organization.
Yeah, we can end it there, Julie. I mean, this, you know, for I think many of us, on top of all the things we've talked about, on top of the ability to set yourself up financially for the future and have a great career, this is what keeps us all here. This is the reason that, you know, I've been here 18 years, Kevin's been here 18 years, Julie's been here basically 18 years, Jake's coming up on 5. It's the people side of it. That's what's most important to all of us. I can't count the number of Cintas weddings that I've been to, and certainly it's the reason why we know that LinkedIn's pretty popular, right? People get reached out to all the time. I can tell you in 18 years I've never taken a call from a recruiter because I wouldn't leave all these people and all that other stuff. So we'll pause it there, answer any questions about anything that we covered or quite frankly anything else that you all have, and let you get back to your days.
Thanks, guys. Any questions? Anything else we can answer while you got us? Yes, sir.
I'm curious, recently it seems like there's pretty clear trends in the job market of less job stability, or, you know, less of a culture of like staying at one company for a very long time. So you said at Cintas, you guys are very focused on promoting from within and moving up and upward mobility. Is that something that's going to continue despite that trend?
I mean, I don't think that's a new trend. That was a trend when I came out of school. And I remember I had a buddy who was working in advertising in New York City, and he even told me if you stay with the company too long, it's a negative thing. And he was intent. He's like, I've been here 3 years. I need to move on, because in the advertising world, it's looked at as you're not eager to do more, right? But at Cintas, Joel, 18 years, me, 18 years, Scott, the gentleman who runs Boston that I alluded to, was my boss that got me up here at the time, 22 years. Most of our executives or MTs brought up. It's odd because I haven't seen that at Cintas. The executive grooming program brings them in and we stay here and we have careers, but it's to that point of what I just said. Anytime I thought I needed to make more money or I had to look somewhere else, I've been challenged. I've had to lead completely different teams in different parts of the country, and I didn't have to look outside. So, you know, I would argue that our company allows for growth and development and opportunity, but you do not have to look outside, where that is a trend. And we've proven time and time again that we buck the system with that trend, and it's not a new trend in my opinion.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people look for those opportunities because they don't find what they want at the place they're at, right? And so why we've talked so much about the different career paths you can have and the opportunity to advance not only your different job, but let's be honest, your compensation, how you're taken care of within one organization and not have to change, that's appealing, you know, because changing jobs is uncomfortable. Going through an interview process, you know, somebody told me once, at least it was a customer, that the grass is always greener over the septic. And I was like, huh, that's an interesting thought. Right? But you think about it, there's something in what you know, and as long as that organization takes good care of you and you feel like you've got a trajectory to move forward and you're continuously taken care of, well, why would you go somewhere else? Now, if that stops, hey, time to look, right? Like any relationship. But at Cintas, I don't think it's that way, and I don't think it's gonna change to that. Moreover, because we can't lose people. We can't lose talent. We need talented people. If you take a $7 billion company and double it in size in 10 years, just think about how many more people we need to do our job. Because we're not, you know, we're not Google, where one person can like sit on a computer and do a bunch of different things. We are a very people-focused business that need a lot of people to get the job done, which honestly, I think is a good thing, because it's stability for all of us that are here.
Fair question, though.
At what part, at what point in your careers right now are you on that chart that you showed?
I'm one about 10, whatever it was. I'm kidding.
I had his job before. Yeah, it's hard to tell. So Kevin's the general manager, so he's one of probably, 300 general managers, and there's probably another 150 branch managers. The only difference between general and branch is general, you have a processing facility. Branch, you don't wash your own stuff, somebody else does. So I'm a sales director. I'm one of maybe 45 sales directors in the company, but then we also have service directors, production directors, HR directors as well. So at the GM director level, I don't know, out of 40,000 people, there's probably 500 of us. And what's above our roles, you start getting into kind of what we look at as executives, meaning one of our vice presidents or senior vice presidents to move up.
Yeah, that's a tough question to answer. I kind of jokingly responded to Joel on that, but it goes back to that lattice of like it's hard to rank because he's in sales, I'm in ops, and my next move could be a sales director or a vice president of something. Joel's next move could be an operational director. It's we go back and forth, right? And that's it's not a ladder anymore. It's interconnected. So.
Well, that's very normal too, because you learn a skill set and then you can make an impact in another piece of the business. You know, what I learned as a general manager assisted me as a sales director. What I've learned as a sales director will assist me if I'm, say, a service director next, or if I, you know, go to another division and run one of those. So it's hard to say where we're at. I mean, I like where my W-2's at, if that's what you're asking, but I mean, it can always go higher, so.
How many years of the company would you say you have to work before you get to that point where you're choosing where you want to work, not trying to go up?
Three. Yeah. So, and I say three because 2 years as a management trainee, and then at least a year as a successful sales partner, and then you're kind of, you know, choose your own adventure. And Kevin talked about the opportunities that he didn't accept at the time. Similar for myself, after making three President's Clubs, it's like, hey, Joel, where do you want to go? You want to be a sales manager in Philadelphia? Do you want to be a service manager in Portland? Do you want to be a sales manager in this market? And I didn't want to move at the time. So, and I wanted to move through operations to become a GM. So that was the reason I did what I did. But, yeah. Great question. Anything else?
I guess, so what are some, like, I mean, you know, when you see college graduates, you always see, look at, you know, grades and classes they have taken. What are some characteristics of, you know, grads that make them, you know, stand out to you, like different than just like the regular stuff, I guess, that
I can answer that, and then certainly you guys can too. I mean, I'll tell you that grades are important, but it's actually not the first thing I look at. You know, as long as you've got respectable grades, what's more important to me is what else have you done while going to school? You know, I love people that worked throughout going to school. I love athletes. I love people that were part of a different group, because let's call a spade, just going to school full time, you still got a lot of spare time, right? So like, what else did you do to challenge yourself and get better and kind of make yourself more well-rounded? So that's what I look at. If somebody has, you know, average to above average grades and was doing other things, then that's the kind of person that we want. You know, we're a blue collar company. You know, you can make a white collar living in a blue collar company. So all people that aren't afraid of hard work and know what it's like to work with different people and value that, that's most important.
Yeah, I look for, I say the word grit all the time, but really what that means is I'm looking for people that have overcome adversity in their lives. Do you have examples of, hey, here's the situation, here's the where I was, here's the action I took, and here's the ultimate result that came out of that? That shows me past performance is
best indicator of future success, right? And at Cintas, I'd say we're in a leadership development business, and I think I talked a little bit about the P&L, and I can hire somebody that understands it, but that's fine. You got to be able to take that information. That's an aspect of it, and you need to be smart enough to manage our finances and manage the business. But most importantly, you got to be able to lead and be able to deal with multiple personalities. Joel had mentioned our customer base being very diversified, right? And that's great when we have things like a pandemic that wipes out hospitality and takes up our healthcare volume because we're so diversified. But that also means that we have to talk and be able to relate to C-suite executives or major hospitals when we're talking to an EVS department, and then the small garage down the street or the Italian deli owner who's gonna be very direct with you and use choice words as part of his vocabulary, and they're all customers. And we have to be able to adapt our business style to influence our products and services and the people we work around. And that's what I see. Is I like the guy that walked onto the team and earned his spot as a starter, or the girl that, you know, was in school, earned a scholarship, and was working two jobs to get through school in addition to the academic report card. Shows me there's a little bit more there than just the intelligence. The intelligence and the grades are very important, but I think there's more with leading people, and Cintas is very much a leadership organization. Yes, sir.
Joel, you were the one that brought up the outside of academics, and you were in finance, and you mentioned Bob Strong. Did you do Spiffy while you were here?
I did. Yeah, I did, and it's funny because when Professor Strong told me about the Cintas meeting, he also said, like, hey, also see if the stock you think would be a good pick for us for Spiffy. Yeah, it definitely would have been a good pick for us. I mean, when I joined Cintas and started getting shares of Cintas stock, it was in the mid to high 20s, and I think closed yesterday at like 380. So, pretty good investment. It's been pretty good for all of us as well. But yeah, Spiffy was awesome. When I could, because I worked full time. I worked at Hannaford full time and went to school full time. And then I worked at Best Buy on the weekends to make more money, because I don't know, I like things. Anything else? Well, I'll say this too. We've got our cards out back, and whether you decide to pursue a career at Cintas or not, connect with us on LinkedIn, shoot us an email, shoot us a phone call. My cell phone number's on my card, and I'll be happy to chat, answer any questions. We certainly don't have all the answers, but we can give you our perspective just based on our experience. But good luck with the rest of this year. If you're graduating, congrats to all of you that are. And then if you're not graduating this year, it'll come pretty darn fast. So it's good that you're looking at stuff right now, too.
Thank you.
Hopefully next time we meet, we don't have to wear these things, right?
Yep.